I am Randy Iden. I'm the faculty director of the MSC program, and you guys are incoming students to the MSC, which we are so excited about. And we want to continue to welcome you by giving you some ideas of what you're in store for in your exciting MSC year. And to give you a little bit of a sample of who the people are behind this program and what you're going to see as you begin to take classes and so forth. Today, our guest we're really excited about is Professor Noshir Contractor. He is the Jane S. and William J. White Professor of Behavioral Science in three different places. He has three separate appointments at Northwestern in the McCormick School of Engineering, the School of Communication, which is the place that the MSC is housed, and also in the Kellogg School of Business. So he works with all of those areas. And he is at the forefront, he really is one of the leaders in the interdisciplinary study of networks, network science, computational social science, and web science. And he teaches a class in understanding and leveraging networks, which you will take as your core class in the spring quarter at Northwestern. And so first of all, just welcome, Noshir. It's so nice for you to be with us today. I just asked him about his background, and why don't you go ahead and tell everyone what are you sitting in front of?
I'm sitting in, first of all, hi everyone. I'm really excited to get a chance to do this. There are lots and lots of challenges that we are all facing at this moment, but I'm always looking for the bright spots, and getting a chance to have a conversation like this with all of you is definitely an honor, a privilege, and one that I think will go a long ways in helping us, you know, build, as we shall see, our not only your cohort, but also our community overall, et cetera. So I'm really thrilled to be a part of this. And thank you for taking time out of your schedule to spend some time here with us today as well. To go back to Randy's question, so the background, the virtual background that you see out there is, it says the word Sonic, and I direct a lab here at Northwestern, which is called the Science of Networks in Communities, S-O-N-I-C, and that's where the Sonic comes from. And then before we got on, Randy was asking me about the background. He said that looks kind of very space-like, et cetera. And it's true that I do some work in space research, helping NASA prepare for our teams to go to the moon and onto Mars. But that is actually not a space motif, the one behind me. It's a visualization of a network. And it was the graphic that was used on the cover of my book that I wrote on theories of communication networks about 15 years ago now, more than that. And it was published by Oxford. And so I liked the cover of that, and I never found much use for it. And then lo and behold, we get to Zoom and we go, oh, virtual background. I'm like, oh, okay, well, what virtual background should I put? And so the folks in my lab came up with the graphic and the logo. And so that's the virtual background that you're looking at there. But it does reflect the fact that I do think networks and live and breathe networks most of the time. And so I'm happy to have that as my virtual background.
So Noshir, can you tell us a little bit about how you got interested in the study of networks, and particularly how it relates to the study of communication that we'll all be engaging in as part of the MSC?
Yeah, absolutely. So Randy mentioned that I have three appointments, but my PhD is in communication. And so my undergraduate, though, is in electrical engineering and from India. And then when I came to the United States as a graduate student in 1983, I went to the University of Southern California. And while I was a student there in my second year, there was a professor who was offering a class in social network analysis. It's hard to believe that in 1983, people were studying about social networks, just not the social networking platforms that we think about today, but they were studying these things. And so it was a class of about eight students. And the instructor's name was Everett Rogers. He's passed on since then. But Ev was one of the doyens, one of the founders, if you may, of social network analysis as a discipline or as an interdiscipline. And he was in communication. So he wrote a classic book called Communication Networks. And that sort of got my attention initially, Randy, because I was an engineering major as an undergrad, and I thought I had taken classes on communication networks. It's just a different kind of communication networks. It was the actual hardware, the plumbing network. And so I was intrigued by it, and I said, oh, I suppose you can apply that to people. And so I took his class, and he did warn us on that day. Now, this takes on a whole different connotation these days, but he opened the seminar for six or seven students in the class by saying, I want to warn you that what I'm about to do is infect you with an idea. The idea I'm going to infect you with is that everything in the world revolves around networks. And once you're infected with this idea, you will see networks everywhere. Every problem will be a network problem. Every solution will be a network solution. And you'll never be able to get rid of this virus. This is exactly what he told us. And I must say that he infected me, Randy. And so on that day onwards, I made it my mission to try to, again, infect is probably not a good choice of terms under the present circumstances, but spread the word for sure about this issue. And so I was very interested in understanding why we create the links we do and what are the consequences of doing that. And one of the things I've discovered over the years is as I talk to folks about it, most of us have not spent a lot of time thinking about it in the sense that, you know, why is it that, what made me do it? What made me connect with certain other people? And then, you know, but it has consequences. And there's loads and decades of research that show that there are massive consequences associated with people's decisions about who to connect with. I like to say, we need to know about how networks form because we need to know about how networks perform.
That's great. So last week, for those of you who are with us, we had Professor Leslie DeChurch, who works with Noshir. And by the way, as I go back and forth between those two names, one thing I just want to point out in terms of the conventions of the MSC is, as long as I've been a part of the MSC, which goes back to the year 2000, it has always been customary for students, if they were comfortable doing so, to call the faculty by their first names. And that's something that is relatively common for all graduate students. It's something that sometimes people who have been raised in a particular way or have a certain understanding of manners and respect find difficult to do. And we're always happy to respond to other respectful terms, such as Professor Contractor. But you should always feel free, and I'm speaking out of turn for you, Noshir, but to refer to him directly by his first name, to Leslie by her name, to me as Randy, and so forth. But in any case, last week, Leslie spoke about her work with NASA and helping to design the best kind of teams that would be most effective, efficient, and not kill each other on a trip to Mars. And you've worked on that same grant from the network perspective. And so I'm curious as to what is the role of networks in designing an effective team?
Oh, it's incredibly important. And also I'll add that it's we've got some good results that show that it's not just anecdotally important to us. There is this very, very strong evidence base now that we put together. So you already know a little bit about the work we're doing. I won't give you too much in the rationale, but assuming some of you were not on the call last week, the work that we're doing is that as we get ready to send the first woman and the next man back to the moon under this thing called the Artemis. Artemis is the sister of Apollo. And so that's the new mission. The Apollo mission is now, the sequel is going to be called the Artemis mission. And one of the things that NASA is very interested in is as we think about going to the moon and Mars, you know, we get to design all the technology that is going to carry the humans into space. But there's one thing that NASA doesn't get to design, and that's the human being. They have to live with humans as we know them, which means that for the last now 5 decades, we've learned a lot about what are the physiological impacts of being in space on the human body, whether it's lack of gravity, weightlessness, whether it's radiation, et cetera. But now, as we begin to think about longer trips, trip to Mars that would take 9 months to get there, and you have to stay there for 9 months and come back, as you start doing those kinds of things, you'll see that the NASA is getting more interested, not just in the physiological impacts on humans, but also on the psychosocial impacts. There's one Russian cosmonaut who has a fantastic quote that said that putting two people into an 18 by 10 feet confined space is a sure recipe for them wanting to kill each other, especially if you have that for a long period of time. So that's sort of where the relationships between people become so important, Randy, in understanding that, you know, you have to be able to predict it. So a lot of what we are doing is learning by putting people into these isolated, confined environments at the Johnson Space Center in Houston, also in, at a similar facility in Moscow. And the Russians and the US collaborate very closely on this. And so we get to see these people put into confined spaces for 30 days initially, 45 days. In Russia, we just finished one with 120 days. And now we're coming up later this year to study people being put in confinement for 240 days. And each of those cases, we get to psychologically poke and prod them by asking them to talk about their network ties to each other. Who do you think is a hindrance? Who do you enjoy working with? Who do you look to leadership? And we collect that data every 2 or 3 days. And then we look at all the other things that are going on in their situation. How much of communication delay they have talking to mission control because they are simulating an actual trip to an asteroid or Mars, et cetera. And so we ask them all these survey questions, and then we look at all the factors that might explain why is it that A and B are getting along, or why is it that they will stop getting along, or why would they do different kinds of things about each other. And so what we have done now is build some really sophisticated models that allow us to predict on what day who is not going to get along with whom and why. And now when we did that, we were very proud about that. It was great science, you know, that was fantastic. But then very soon when we went back to NASA and presented this work to them, they said, this is fantastic. We had a very successful session in last year at the American Association for the Advancement of Science, which is the largest single science conference in the world. It was in Washington, D.C., and we had a whole session about the kind of work that NASA is doing preparing humans to go to Mars. Got a lot of press coverage. I can send you links on the articles that we were quoted on The Economist. There were podcasts, etc. But then NASA came back and said, prediction is not enough. We need prescription. It's good to know that A and B won't get along well on a certain day. What do we do to fix that? And so we were looking at how we could assign the only degrees. We can't say, okay, you know, the only limited number of prescriptions that we can give people who are hurtling through space at incredible speeds, and we can't tell one person to go, you know, sit at the corner, so to speak. And so we came up with what kinds of activities they should or shouldn't be doing together. They all have things to do, but we have some flexibility. Oh, today, you know, it was A and B was supposed to work on repairing that or doing some maintenance job on the spacecraft. But instead of that, why don't we have B and C work on it? And we call that repairing the people who are working on things. And I was very proud of the fact that repairing crew members also helps repairing crew relationships. And so that was my sort of contribution to the project, a turn of phrase to be able to look at those kinds of things. But all of those are network ties, and that's what we are modeling in those cases.
Do you think that there's an application of this of these findings to the more mundane offices that most of us are working in?
Absolutely. In fact, I couldn't agree more with you. Now, what is happening is that the difference is that in a regular mundane, as you said, office, asking people to fill up these network surveys every 2 or 3 days is not going to fly, right? And that has been typically one of the obstacles associated with taking ideas that we know about why networks matter and being able to implement it in organizations. There are some very well-known organizational consultants who work in this area. I've done my share of it myself. But the challenge has always been, how do you get the data to be able to then make something actionable? And Randy, one of the things that I co-authored an article with a former faculty member who also used to teach in the MSC program here at Northwestern. He's now at University of California, Santa Barbara. His name is Paul Leonardi. Paul and I published an article about a year and a half ago in Harvard Business Review, where we talked about people analytics. And where we really were talking about is that while people have been thinking about people analytics and understanding people's personality and how well they might do in an organization, we were really making the case that we should focus not just on individual attributes of people, but relational analytics, their social networks. And the advantage now, the game changer now, is that in some cases, we don't even actually have to ask people to fill up social network surveys. A lot of the data that we're generating by looking at what we call metadata, who's Zooming with whom, who's Slacking whom, who's sending team messages to whom, not the content, just the metadata associated with it. How quickly does someone reply to you? That is now being used to provide a lot of really interesting insights into organizations. I know that Microsoft Teams has approached me. They're working on making the data from the people using Microsoft Teams will very soon be able to get these kinds of analytics about what they are doing, what kinds of networks they're engaging in. And it's being given to each individual person to help them understand their network, but it's also being given to management to just get a sense of the health of the network. There are huge privacy issues that we are navigating through this. But on the other hand, I think to go back to your point, Randy, having these kinds of techniques being used now and shown to be demonstratively useful in the space context will in fact pay dividends back on Earth. And I tell my colleagues who are doing research funded by NASA in the physical and life sciences that we've known for a long time that NASA has been very proud of the fact that many things that were first invented for travel, for space travel, now have huge dividends back on Earth, from mundane things like the portable drill that Black & Decker or any of your favorite ones are made, that originally was designed for astronauts who would not be able to hold things with two hands, et cetera, when they were drilling for soil on the moon. The light-emitting diode, the lights that are used there, those were used on rockets because they were conserving energy. Today, of course, LEDs are used all over the planet. Water filtration systems that were built because in a rocket, you had to recycle all the water that you were generating and recycle it to make it drinkable again. Today, all of that is really helping large tracts of Africa and the developing world to provide water filtration systems that are local and cannot use some of the other technologies that we are used to when we get water, I'm trying to get the name of the person who's doing that, Santucci, who's drinking a bottle of water there, right? So she's just drinking it there, but in parts of Africa, you don't have that option. There you go. And so those are the kinds of ways in which I think that NASA has had dividends back on Earth. And I like to say that the kind of work we are doing is amongst the first instances where the social science that is being done for NASA might also have bigger dividends back in the mundane office, as you said, Randy.
Yeah. And I think that's one of the things that's most interesting to me. And hearing Noshir talk about networks gave me a whole different understanding and appreciation for what a network is. How it can be used. We typically think of it as the thing that we automatically want to appear when we need something. And what you learn in Noshir's class is how to appreciate networks in a completely different way. He also gives you a really good illustration of the way the university works, from theoretical research to ideas that you can take back to your companies and your professional areas and so forth, which is why one of the mottos of the MSC is what you learn on Saturday, you can use on Monday morning. But I want to turn to a different issue here, which is we know that Professor Contractor Noshir is an incredibly busy person, three different appointments, lots of graduate students, lots of open grants, undergraduate teaching responsibilities. And you all know, because we've talked about this, that no faculty member is assigned MSC teaching as part of their normal teaching load. Each faculty member that you get is there because they want to be there, because they've chosen to be there. So let me ask you this, Noshir, as we've talked through this discussion of how you get from your theoretical ideas into your research and the way those research ideas can be applied. What do you get out of teaching in the MSC? What's in it for you?
Okay, I'm always happy to answer that question because I think it's a win-win situation. At least I hope it's a win for you, but it's certainly a win for me. And that is one of the things that, and maybe this is because of my undergraduate sort of engineering sensibility, I'm not sure, but one of the things that I've always kept front and center is the so what question. And so when I do research, and I'll talk a little bit about that over the course of the quarter when we are together. I am very, very interested in advancing theory. That's definitely something that is very near and dear to my heart, and also very interested in using innovative methods. But at the end of the day, it's all about the so what question. And that means, how do I take what I'm doing and make it actionable? I'm very fond of saying that it's not enough to give people a dashboard. You need to give them a do board, that they can do something with it. It's not enough to show people pretty pictures of networks. It's important for them to be able to do something with that. And so one of the short answer to your question is classes like the MSC class, hanging out with the students and continuing to stay engaged with you after you've graduated, is what keeps me honest. Because it makes me understand and appreciate, is what I am researching really relevant and actionable? Is what, and in many ways it changes what I'm doing, because you ask questions that are, to me, are incredibly valuable data points that make me understand what is it that I should be looking at? What are the pressing questions today? I'll give you an example. One of the former graduates from the MSc program is a person by the name of Nadia Cranen. So Nadia is here in Chicago. She is the co-founder of a company called Forte Group, F-O-R-T-E Group. Nadia was a student in the class, got interested in networks and stayed in touch. And then lo and behold, as things developed, she said, you know, I really think she co-founded a company with her husband, Steve, that does sort of software development kinds of things. But now her company and I are collaborating on a research project where what we're doing is we are, just a few minutes ago, I mentioned to you that we can collect digital trace data and see if we can predict what people would say on a survey, saving time, et cetera. One of the places we're doing that is at Forte, her company. And we are in the process of doing that right now, right in the middle of COVID, actually, which is quite interesting, where we've got digital trace data from their use of things like Skype, et cetera, before the COVID crisis, during the COVID crisis. We are doing a survey during the COVID crisis, asking them who talks to whom, and then using our models to see if we can predict what people would have said in a survey based upon how they interact on channels like Slack and Skype, et cetera. Now, why is this relevant to what Randy's saying? Because one of the things we are doing is we are giving them tools. They themselves said, we are really interested in this. We want to be able to use these tools. And so not only am I able to advance my research, but in the process, we are giving them an opportunity to say, I'm going to show you a dashboard, a relational analytics dashboard, that based on our model will predict who trusts whom, who seeks advice from whom, and help you make decisions about when you put teams together, which are the right people to put together on teams based upon their social networks. To me, those are all the work that I try to do is to solve real problems, whether it is a problem of understanding who's the influencer, who are the people who should form a team together, who are the people who are going to be good at telling you what other people think, who is likely to be more innovative. These are all pain points that organizations face. Who's about to leave the company and voluntarily? And so all of these are pain points that we are trying to address with our work. And so talking to folks like you is what keeps me and my research agenda honest.
Excellent, that's great. And from my perspective as a student of language, I think one of the most fascinating things about Noshir's story is that he started in electrical engineering with the literal networks, the way that electrical grids and networks were created. And then he came to graduate school and studied something that was metaphorical networks, in a sense. And then one of the things that he's now done in his research is to take those metaphorical human networks and conceptualize them as actual legitimate networks, and to show how that gets used. And that in itself is a nice metaphor for the way that the MSC program integrates with Northwestern School of Communication and Department of Communication Studies, is because what you all represent is a diversity of experience that is different than the experience that we get on a daily basis in our work. And we are also different and represent a diversity of the experience that you get in your general world. And so what ends up happening is a metaphorical network that can become a real network because of the way that ideas, and as you can see in the story we just heard, the way projects are exchanged. So hopefully that gives you, whets your appetite a little bit, but the lesson is bring your problems with you. Bring your questions, bring your curiosity. Don't be afraid ever when somebody like Noshir, as estimable as he is, as elite a scientist as he is, don't be afraid to raise your hand and say, that doesn't make sense to me. That's not what I've seen in my company. That's not the way I've experienced it. He won't take that question as an insult or a threat to his status. He'll take that question as a really interesting challenge to explore. And so bring that attitude. I see that we're close to out of time, but I did want to leave room in case people had questions. If you have questions, feel free to put them into the chat. And we'll be glad to take them there. Or I can't know if I can see everybody, but if you would raise your hand, which you can do with reactions or just wave at me, I'll try to call on you as well. Anybody have questions that they want to ask about this? It's interesting that, it was great that we had this combination of having Leslie first and then Noshir second. That's exactly the way you'll experience them, although you'll get Mike Roloff in the middle of that for some comic relief. But the connection between these two classes is one of the most fortuitous parts of the way the MSC program has been designed. Because I think that what we see is that people are living much more in collaborative workspaces. The idea of what communication in those spaces means is changing. And the very fact that we're holding this this meeting in this forum, which has become so common to all of us, is a perfect example of how thinking about what a team is, what your position in the team is, what does leadership mean in a more complicated way, and specifically as it relates to what Noshir does, thinking about your networks in a different way. I think the thing that scared me the very most the first time I heard Noshir speak about this was, all of a sudden, after all of the insecurity that every one of us has about the way we look and our intelligence and our background and our success and so forth, I had a brand new thing to be worried about, which was, how would somebody judge my network? That's a scary thing, I think, at first blush. But one of the things that unites people in the MSC, I think the single thread that runs through MSC students, is an appreciation for the importance of organizations. Making organizations better, living up to the potential of those organizations and their missions and so forth. And that's what we're really trying to get to. Let's see what we got.
I know we are, Colette had to leave. I just have one quick thing, since Randy brought up the pairing of that Leslie's class and my class. If some of you are interested, it's a shameless plug, but tomorrow we are doing a webinar called Research on Astronauts Can Teach Us About Teaming in a Virtual World, what network science and research on astronauts can teach us about working together apart. I'm going to put the link in the chat, which of course will disappear once you leave, but it's on tomorrow from noon to one. And then the second thing that Randy mentioned is that the talk that I will be giving in a couple of weeks, I think it is, or a few weeks, and as part of the MSC webinar series, will in fact be focused on the ick factor. That is the extent to which we all think that networking is somehow some kind of an oily, sleazy thing. And so let's just talk about that openly, because it is in fact the case. Many people think that networking is a rather icky, slimy thing. And so the talk that I'm going to be giving in a few weeks is going to specifically focus on that. And hopefully we'll find a way to flush that out of our system. So I know we are over time by a minute.
Yeah, that's fine. But thank you so much, Noshir. That was really interesting. If you have questions that come up for Noshir, feel free to forward them to me, and we'll get them to him. You can also just reserve them for when we get to meet as a class later on. But I want to thank everybody for taking some time in the middle of the day. I want to continue to welcome you to the program and look forward to more meetings. We'll be with you again next Wednesday as well.
Thanks for you again, everyone.
Have a good afternoon. Thank you, Noshir.
Thank you. Bye-bye.